My name is Roy Kring. Welcome to the Joe Blaine Farm Museum here in Bedford, Massachusetts. We'll go inside the house in just a minute, but first I want to tell you about the Joe Blaine Farm. As far back as anyone can remember, this was Native American homeland. The first people hunted, they canoed the river, they camped and made their trails here. There was not a Native American village here when the English came. They didn't see any houses or fields of corn and squash and beans. The English thought it would be fine for them just to take the land for themselves. In 1637, the Massachusetts legislature gave 2,000 acres to the governor, John Winthrop, and the deputy governor, Thomas Dudley. After doing a little research of my ancestry, I was surprised to discover that Thomas Dudley is my 9th great-grandfather. Well, Governor Winthrop did not move here, so there were still no houses or crops growing. He willed it to his son, who willed it to his son, named Fitz John Winthrop. Fitz John didn't live here either. He lived in Connecticut. So he bartered the land to a carpenter named Joe Blaine. Joe built Fitz John a big house in Connecticut. Then Joe came back and built a house and barn for himself and his family. It was located down the road, but it's not there anymore. They began to farm the land, and it was a huge farm. It stretched from what is now Apple Tree Lane in the north to Bedford Farms in the south, Fawn Lake in the east, and the Concord River in the west. There was plenty of room for growing crops and raising animals, hunting and fishing, and taking care of a family. Joe Blaine had a grandson, also named Job. He was born on the farm and grew up in the house his grandfather built. But when the younger Job got married, he wanted a house for his own family. He built this very house over 300 years ago in 1713. The house he built was only half the house you see today. It included the rooms on the right behind the four windows and the door. The left side of the house was built 100 years later. And now, let's go into the house where Sharon McDonald is waiting for us.
My name is Sharon McDonald, and I'm a volunteer guide here at the Joe Blaine House. I want to introduce you to the Lane family, but they're not here. They lived 300 years ago, but in your imagination, maybe you can see Joe Blaine, the father. He's a farmer, but he's also a deacon of the church and a lieutenant in the militia. Your school is named after him, Joe Blaine, Lieutenant Joe Blaine School. You can also see Martha. She's the mother. And she does the sewing, the cooking, the gardening, the spinning, the soap making. She does everything that a colonial woman has to do to run a house. Now there are seven children. There's young Martha, named after her mother. Young Martha is sewing a sampler. And there's Job Jr., who is learning to play the fife. He wants to be a soldier when he grows up. There's Timothy, who is writing his ABCs on a slate. And there's John, who's practicing spinning his tops. When you spin your tops and one slams into the other one and makes it stop, the other one is the winner. Now, Benjamin is in the cradle. Benjamin is disabled, and his parents worry about him all his life. And there's a little child singing, "London Bridge is falling down." That's Mary, and she's 4 years old. Now, Lucy, the youngest sister, isn't here because she isn't born yet. Job Lane and Martha had some sadness in their life. They had four more children, but the children died when they were still babies. So these seven that I've told you are the children that lived to grow up. Now Job Lane built this house probably with the help of his neighbors, don't you think? And he built it as beautifully as he could. And he used as his model a salt box. The salt box is what you keep salt in when you're a colonial cook. And the shape of the cover of the salt box is the same as the shape of the roof of the house. So they call the house the salt box, as well as the salt box a salt box. Job built three fireplaces out of brick to give heat and warmth to the house, and light too. But if there wasn't enough light, you could light a candle. And where did you get the candle? Martha made them. When Job and Martha and the children lived here, Benford didn't exist yet. It was Billerica. This house was in Billerica. Now, there was a law in Massachusetts at that time that you had to go to church every Sunday. If you didn't go to church, you could be fined, you'd have to pay money, or you could be put in the stocks, you know, where you put your arms through and your head through. You could be put in the stocks for not going to church. So Job and Martha had to go to the Billerica church because there was no Bedford church yet. They had to walk. It's about 5 miles. Maybe they rode in their wagon, maybe they rode a horse, but it was very, very bothersome to have to walk in the snow and the rain and the mud. So Job and his neighbors finally said, let's build a new church closer to us. And if you have a church, you can make a town. So people in the south part of Billerica and the eastern part of Concord united and made a new town. And the name of that town was Bedford. And Job Lane and his family were here at the very beginning. Now, you're going to go into the kitchen where Jeanette Potier is waiting for you, and I'll meet you in the parlor later.
Hello, my name is Jeanette, and welcome. This is the kitchen, and the kitchen is a very important room. First, we have a great fireplace behind me that provides heat, as does every room have a fireplace. But in the kitchen, it provides more than that. It provides a way to cook our meals. And I'm going to tell you about the fireplace, the different ovens that we have, the bake oven, the reflector oven, and even the pots. So I don't know how you'll capture the cooking without coals, but I'm going to try. So the kitchen would be set up with a table and probably two chairs. But as you heard, there were more children here. So why not more chairs? Well, they just didn't have more chairs. And children would stand and eat standing up. Now, what and how did they eat? That's an important part of my talk. They had wooden spoons, of course. I personally have a pewter spoon and a knife. So what they did is they took the spoon down and they cut their food. They put their food onto the knife and ate it that way. The knife is not very sharp. However, along the way, a fork was invented. And how was the fork invented? Well, the spoon is cupped and they cut small pieces out of the spoon, which became a fork. However, the first person to come to these shores was John Winthrop, and he had a fork. However, they didn't trust the fork very much, and the reason being is a fork is very pointed, and they were concerned about it. So they didn't favor the fork. They kept eating with their knife and spoon. So how did they cook? Well, the fire had to be made. Wood had to be brought in, and children helped the dad and the mom bring those in. Now remember, this house is very old, so a long time ago, they had no matches. So what did they do? Well, I'm going to attempt a little demonstration. We have here some dried herbs, which I'm sure if there was a spark on them, and this was in the fireplace under the wood, it would catch fire if I could produce a spark. Of course, this is a striker, and this is a flint, and they would snap it until a little spark fell onto something dried, like herbs or grass, and then it would catch fire, and the fire would burn. However, if their fire went out often, they would have to go and borrow coals from a neighbor. So how did they eat here? What did they eat? Well, the fields provided a place for hunting. They had turkeys running wild, deer, rabbit. They also could fish, and then they planted everything that they needed. So over here, I have brought a few things with me. Carrots, of course, the famous potato, onions, but what did the Wampanoag Indians teach the early settlers to plant? They taught them how to plant corn. This is called Indian corn. It's very colorful. However, today we have yellow corn. They planted beans, squash. They also planted, as far as I know, beans and turnips and many, many things. Now, how did they cook them? Well, behind me, if you took a glance at our fireplace, we have a bar, and the bar is a place to hang your pots. However, the other place that you would hang something would be a chicken on a string, and it would turn, and the drippings would go down. But wait, you didn't want the drippings to be lost, so you had a skillet with tall spider legs that would catch the dripping, and there you could cut up your potato and carrot and cook them in there. The other way was the reflector oven. We have an oven here that has no backing. It has a skewer and little area on the side for moving it every 10 minutes so that the chicken would roll around, or piece of meat, and it was said to be done to a turn when all of it had gone a complete turn. Now, what did the children do? Well, they helped outside, not only with wood, but with planting. Mom had to take care of the garden and prepare meals. Grandma was the one who probably did most of the spinning, but children had to peel potatoes and help as well. Boys had to help with the planting, but they had a barn, and cows, pigs, horses were in the barn, and the cows had to be milked twice a day, morning and night. Chickens that they kept for eggs, they had to be fed and provided with water. So the children helped a lot with that. Now, what about the milk? Well, the milk was brought in, and cream separates. For some reason, you would think cream is heavier than milk. It rises to the top. You'd skim off that heavy, beautiful cream, and you would churn it to make butter. All the fat gets together, clumps together, and makes butter. But the best part, there is something left in that, and that is buttermilk. And if you've never had buttermilk, ask for some and try it. I once served some here to the children, because I've been doing this tour for children for so many years that parents come with their children, and they were kids when they came and saw my little tour. So what else did we do? Well, we played games, didn't we? Not all the time, but we have some tops and some games. They helped make candles too, and we made our own soap. So as you see, there was a lot to do. And there are three fruits that I think are native to America. I say cranberries. You can buy them dried as well. Blueberries. Blueberries used to be able to be picked by buckets, and they were also dried. And I like to say that we had a native grape. That's up for discussion. However, grapes are a great product to cook or to juice. As well, they planted trees, apple trees, peach trees. Those were great to make a juice. However, they didn't drink water very much like we do today. They didn't believe in that. So, in all, we had a great life. I personally have cooked in those hearth ovens as well. You put them over a hot coal, you heat them up, you can put a meat pie in it, and when you in fact put your cover on, it has an indention of an inch to put more hot coals. I have cooked many meat pies at encampments. The food cooked in an open fire seems to be better than cooked in the modern way today. I don't know why. Maybe memories. Anyhow, we hope you come and visit us. I always love the kitchen, and I'll tell you a lot more about it if you could come and visit with us. Thank you.
Hello again. This is the parlor. Joe Blaine didn't build this parlor. It was built 100 years after Joe Blaine by his step-great-grandson, Oliver Abbott. His last name wasn't Lane because he was a stepson, but he was the last Lane to live in the house. Now, when Oliver moved here, he bought the house for $1,000. And moved here, and he really wanted a bigger house. He wanted a bedroom upstairs and a little room behind. He wanted a bigger kitchen. He wanted a bigger cellar, and he wanted this parlor. So there were lots of changes happening here. And while they were happening, there was a fellow who lived in Billerica whose name was Rufus Porter. He was an artist, he was a school teacher, he was a musician, and he was an itinerant painter. That means that he traveled from place to place advertising, "I'll paint your wall," not like a house painter, but painting murals on the wall, painting beautiful, beautiful murals on the wall. Now he became quite famous for his paintings and his inventions, and 2 books have been written about him. When he painted the walls of the parlor, he painted all 4 walls in his usual style, which was to put mountains in the background, a river in the front with little boats in it, houses on the ground in between, and beside each door and each window in the room, he put a tree. Do you like it? And now I give it over to Jeanette.
Hello again. I love this room. It's so beautiful. And it was purchased by Heron Dutton, so it became now a home where the Duttons lived. Now, when the Duttons lived here at first, the walls had been wallpapered because it was much later than Oliver Abbott's time. So when we, with the town of Bedford, decided to make this into this beautiful museum, we removed the paper and the murals were restored. So what about the Duttons? Well, Lillian Dutton had lost her husband and she had 2 young daughters, Olive and Eleanor. The barn was across the street, so she decided she would make cottage cheese to sell. And later, she decided to have an herb business, which she used to mail to people. And she became quite well known for her herbs. Now, the Duttons had a lot going on here as well. So Olive came to visit us, the youngest daughter, and told us about living here as a young girl and how they survived all those cold winters when they had to stand on soapstone to wash dishes. However, what they're known for today is Lillian's garden is outside this room on the west side. Now, I personally take care of the garden with a number of other people. The garden is a result of the Bedford Garden Club, who conceived the idea, and Joe Champney, who just turned 100 years old on April 30th of this year, was the one who planned the garden. The garden actually has colonial period herbs in it. What I have here is oregano. You probably have pizza a lot. They put oregano on pizza. So there are natural herbs that are from long ago, and there are herbs that we use today. As a matter of fact, there are four raised beds, and some of the plants were found in the field, so Joe rescued those. But of all the herbs in the beds, two beds we have now dedicated mostly to medicinal herbs, because doctors were not close by, and in addition to all the work that the family had to do, they had to create their own medicine. So we wanted to create a garden that represented life long ago. The other thing is, we now have a barn. We have no animals here, but our barn is beautiful. And when Olive came with her daughter Gail, in the barn, I was able to warm up a beef stew. We ate in the great hall for supper after a tour. And I particularly made a grape pie, because Lillian Dutton had a Concord grape. And now here her daughter was years and years later after the death of her mother, but the grape still grows here. And now the youngest daughter of Olive, Carol, does come and visit us and chats with us, and we do love to have her come for a tea. The barn is used for children's games on the second Sunday of the month. We're usually open May through October. However, we are not yet open this year. The other thing is, our barn is also available for rentals. So if you come and visit us during normal visiting hours, you may be able to play kids' games. You may be able to see the upstairs of the house. So we really would like to see you back here. Thank you very much. Maybe you could also become members. We're always looking for members to become guides, also greeters and shopkeepers. We have a lovely little shop in the barn. So do come and visit. Thank you. And thank you, Sharon.